Now you're working.
We're just still waiting a few minutes for viewers to dial in.
Okay. I try again.
Everyone is organizing their settings, and we'll get started in just a few seconds. Welcome to everyone around the globe who's joining us today for the second session on decolonizing memory and knowledge. My name is Katja Donovan, and I'm the executive director of 1014. We are a nonprofit organization providing a platform for interdisciplinary projects that address global topics for a more just and equitable future. I am very much looking forward to the upcoming discussion, but also to the artistic contributions. Thank you to Gladys Kalichini for joining us today and for sharing your thoughts and art. And of course, a big thank you to today's curators, Isabel Raabe and Mahret Ifeoma Kupka. Isabel, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Katja, for this nice introduction. So welcome back after a very inspiring and thought-provoking talk about mapping academia, about Black studies we just had. So for those who just jumped in and missed the first part, today's program is a cooperation, as Katja said, between 1014 Space for Ideas and the Talking Objects Lab, which I am running together with Mahret Ifeoma Kupka and our colleagues in Senegal, Malik Ndiaye from Institut Fondamental d'Afrique Noire, Jim Chuchu and Joki Ngumi from Kenya, from the Nest Collective, and Chao Tayana, also based in Nairobi, from African Digital Heritage. Let me very briefly, I just already did it in the first session, introduce you to the project, Talking Objects, posing the question, what can knowledge be today beyond the Eurocentric knowledge system? And there are some five topics in the foreground. It's decolonizing memory, decolonizing knowledge, the re-evaluation of objects from the so-called colonial context. We are questioning the classical museum practices and preservation and presentation forms. And of course, contemporary artistic perspectives and contribution are very important in this context. Talking Objects consists of the Talking Objects Lab, a series of think tanks, workshops, exhibitions, of which this program is part of, and the Talking Objects Archive, a digital platform that is supposed to be launched in 2024, a platform for decolonial knowledge production based on a curated collection of objects, which can serve as door openers for new epistemologies, new narratives, countering Eurocentric perspectives on knowledge. And everything we did, everything we do, everything we will do in the future, in the upcoming years, can be seen on our blog, talkingobjectslab.org. So welcome to the second part of this event, Pathways of Healing and Caring. And maybe on first sight, it might not be obvious. So we talked about Black studies and now this topic, but they are deeply connected for us as a project dealing with decolonizing memory and knowledge. We must also deal with topics of trauma, caring, and healing. And Naomi Michel just said in the recent panel, and they all were talking about the struggles they are facing, and she said Black studies are life nutrition, so vital food for her. So there we are again on the subject of caring and healing. Our approach to healing is a holistic one. We refer to the interpretation that suggests that healing comes from whole, making things whole. And we are convinced that decolonization processes are, in that sense, not only to deconstruct, to tear down, but also to show what is ignored, to show what is forgotten, to listen what is unheard, and to add what is missing, so to make complete. We started our Talking Objects Lab in June with the performative symposium Unexpected Lessons, where we talked about healing with two artists, Elsa Mbala and Natalie Anguizumu Babikoro. And Natalie Anguizumu said that healing is a constant process. Healing is labor. We cannot do it alone. We have to do it together, because that's what people are doing. We do things together. And we think that this is an aspect that is often forgotten in the debate of restitution and repair and decolonization, that these topics of healing and caring have to be taken into account. So that was my brief introduction. I'm very, very happy to show art from two fantastic artists, Tabita Rezaire and Gladys Kalichini. Tabita can unfortunately not be here with us today, but she sent us an artistic statement we want to show later. But Gladys is here. Welcome, Gladys. I'm happy to have you here. Before we start, our one organizational remark. I want to encourage you to raise questions. You can use the Zoom chat box, and we will try to answer all questions and to come up with a dialogue with our audience. So Gladys, before we have a look at the film, the video you brought with us, called These Practices Are Done in Sharing Her Stories, let me briefly introduce you. You send us a CV, which I'm going to read to you now. Gladys Kalichini is a contemporary visual artist and researcher from Lusaka, Zambia. Her work centers around notions of erasure, memory, and representations and visibilities of women in colonial resistance histories. Gladys is currently a PhD candidate at Rhodes University in South Africa and a member of the Arts of Africa and Global South Research Program, supported by the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation and the National Research Fund. She has participated in ASICO International Art Program in Maputo, Mozambique in 2015, and the second iteration of the Women on Aeroplanes project in Lagos, Nigeria in 2018, themed Search Research Looking for Colette Omobai. Selected residencies that she has participated in include the Fountainhead Residency in Miami, USA in 2017, Künstlerhaus Britannien International Studio Program in Berlin, Germany in 2019 and 20, supported by KfW Stiftung, and the Decoloniale Residency Program also in Berlin. And brand new information, Gladys is on the artist list for the Bamako Encounters 2022. So I'm very happy to have you here, Gladys. We will now see your work. These practices are done in sharing her stories with a length of 4 minutes. Let me briefly add that this is originally a 4-channel installation, and Gladys created a 2-channel split screen version, especially for this event. And thank you, Gladys, that you made this possible. So we're gonna watch the video now.
Bye.
Thank you, Gladys. It's just such a wonderful work, so contemplative and emotional, and the combination of these rituals and the individual gestures. I really love it very much. And I also know how it looks at the four channel installation, but it's really also very, very beautiful to see it online. Thank you.
Welcome.
Gladys, maybe you want to start with telling us a bit about, because this artwork is being created under very special conditions or circumstances, you being caught in South Africa. Maybe you tell us about this process.
When I started working on the work, I was working on the exhibition. So the artwork was one of three installations, was designed to be one of the three installations in the exhibition, These Gestures of Memory. And I had traveled to South Africa because at the time I thought I was going for a 2-week trip and then I would be back. But then when I traveled, there was the lockdowns and the travel bans, and then we couldn't travel anymore. And then there was restrictions on movement, so we really couldn't move or do anything. And then I was thinking on how to make the work. The work then kind of evolved in itself, that I now only had to work with people that were very close to me. So my only contacts at the time of the lockdowns. And at the time, my friends were the closest people I was seeing and the people I was only actually in contact with. And they decided to then help me make the video. So that's how this video ended up being made. And then after making it, the installing of it, also because there was still the travel ban, had to be installed in my absence the first time. So then it moved from having to collaborate with friends to work on it, and having to collaborate with the technical team to put the work up, and which I think in some way added to the meaning of the work. And also, as the work was speaking to taking care or telling particular stories or dealing with particular kind of trauma or erasure, I think it became very good that the work in itself kind of unfolded in this collaborative manner in different layers anyway, I think.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you can feel this intimacy maybe would not be possible if you would not have made it together with close people that are close to you, that understands you without words maybe. Can you elaborate a bit about the title, These Practices Are Done in Sharing Her Stories? I mean, it already tells a bit about what it's about, but maybe you can elaborate a bit on it.
Yeah. Okay. So again, I speak about the artwork in relation to the project as a whole. So the project as a whole was looking at the way in which we commemorate, or looking at commemorating about history, about forgotten histories, particularly those of women freedom fighters in Zambia and Zimbabwe. And I had identified particular maybe gestures or practices that people do to commemorate. So which were things like monuments, which would categorize as state-sanctioned memory. And another way would be the way people do it, maybe in a more personal way, the way in which people perform particular memory practices, either at funerary practices, whether it is the idea of cleansing, whether it is the idea of caring for one another. And so this work kind of really fell very much into practices that people would do. So whether it was like cleansing or anointing. And I kind of like the idea that it really did unfold with three women, particularly kind of caring for each other. Like you say, you've seen the four channel video, and it kind of tries to blur this idea of personal care versus collective care, or personal mourning and collective mourning. So that's why in some videos it's by themselves, and some videos they are washing each other, and then in some videos she's really doing like a full cleanse on herself, and really just kind of like really blurring those lines, but also kind of really considering what it would be like to get into the space of somebody who's experienced some kind of trauma, or because in some way I kind of feel like if you are going to someone and even if you were there to comfort them, it somehow triggers your own trauma. So mm-hmm. in a way that kind of bounces off is what the work was meant to sort of complicate or do.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I mean community practices and solidarity. This is all, and all cleaning the body. These are all aspects of caring, and they are deeply rooted in this work. I start with a huge question: what means caring and healing for you personally? So, let's take it from here.
Yeah, that is a very huge question. Okay, I start with like maybe to care. Like, I don't think I have like an exact definition of what it is to care. I think to care encompasses a lot of things, you know. In my particular case, in my practice, I think to dare to remember mm-hmm. is to care, you know, to think about what is forgotten and to try to maintain not exactly recall back into history, because this is a whole other complication, or it would be a reconstruction of some form, but understanding that reconstruction has its limitation, but this idea to try to remember something or to try to build something from a trace or to hold on from a trace, I think speaks to caring. I think about it also in terms of when people have gone through loss, yeah? We hold on to memorabilia because we care, because it reminds us of something that is important to us, you know? That is what I would say caring is within the context of my work. And I also think it's very much a communal practice, as you say, you know, you can care for the self, but it's also very important to care as a collective or within a community. I think it's a very complex notion though in itself, but you know, it can be looked at in different options, I think. What was the other question? It was to care and to
healing, caring and healing. I mean, deeply connected to each other, of course.
Yeah. Oh, healing again, I think is another complex one, you know, because if you're dealing, particularly in relation to my work, this idea of dealing with things that are past or things that are gone or things that, you know, erasure in itself as a violent thing, there's this need to recuperate or to heal from traumatic histories or just even from the idea that something is absent. I don't think though that it's like something that happens like this. I think it's a process that can be short or it can be long. I don't think there's like a prescribed time frame, I would say. I really think about it in a way of maybe coming to terms with certain things. And I say this in relation to, again, this idea of trying to retrieve the past, because there's times when you can go back and you can retrieve the past and you can come with terms and say, okay, here's the past, and you can put it back. But there's sometimes it's really gone. And then how do you heal from something that's like, it's irretrievable? So I think healing in some way would encompass coming to understanding this failure of retrieving, you know, because sometimes like you are sure some things are invisible or they are gone in history because of maybe third party gestures or something like this, but there's sometimes also that the memory in itself wants to remain hidden, so maybe this negotiation mm-hmm. I think it's a really complex question. I think you said it. It's a very big question.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, we start with a huge one. But it's really not avoiding to forget. Erasure is violence, but this avoiding to forget things we are again at this notion of wholeness, what we, Mahret, always talk about, this understanding of adding the things that are missing. We talk a lot about this, Mahret, right?
I also think I would add that healing obviously is not like a linear, it's not linear. So it, you always have fallbacks, and then you maybe make a jump, and then it's like this very complex process. And as you just said, Gladys, that sometimes there are parts that can't really heal because it's a wound that it's not, like the idea of healing really needs to be rethought, because I think some things can't be made whole again, in the sense that you kind of like look for the missing parts and put them together because mm-hmm. they are kind of lost. But then at the same time, there's the possibility to probably create something new that might feel the gap again. And there are actually two questions, but one question leads back again to your piece. I would love to hear about the music, because the singing is, for me, is also there is a lot of caring in it as well, like listening, hearing those voices like sing together, and the music. So it's
So the song of it is a Catholic hymn that's being sung by women, of course, from the Catholic Church in Zambia, and they are singing in Nyanja Ochewa, which is a language from the Eastern Province. And the idea of the song basically says, pay your respect to the above so that peace may come down, you know. Of course, because it's a religious song, so it does speak in some way to these religious practices or religious beliefs. But I kind of thought about it also, like listening to the lyrics and what it means. I was really more interested in this idea of paying respects to what is no longer there, or acknowledging particular kinds of absences. Like you were just saying right now, that, you know, there's certain things that you can't put back, you know, like certain wounds that cannot be healed. So kind of like engaging or acknowledging this kind of blank, you know? Yeah, so in a way, paying respects to it is what I was really drawn about to the music.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Yeah, I think part of healing is also those wounds that can't be healed, but they need spaces where they can be shown. So that's also an important part of healing, as you said, acknowledging the wounds, but being able to show them, even maybe not even be able to find the words for it, but that's what music and art is for. When there are no words for certain pains, then art or music, which is an art form, can be the language for it. Mm-hmm. I think.
Yeah. I think also important probably to know about the work is that the work really stemmed from research of going through archival photographs in particular archives in Zambia and Zimbabwe, particularly the Independence Archives and the National Archives. And, you know, it's really kind of like dealing with a lot of images, some which can be, which are really violent, and then thinking of how to process this kind of traumatic images or violent images in a way that I do not recreate the violence, you know. So it's in a way also a reenactment, or mm-hmm. a way of engaging with these particular violent images in a not so violent way, by mm-hmm. just a simple gesture of mimicking the color scheme of the photographs and of particular women in particular things, but without actually having to put the women's bodies in a way that is mm-hmm. recreating the violence, or in a way that triggers other kinds of conversation, particularly in relation to specific bodies in history.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
let's talk. I think when we talk about memory and trauma, we have to talk about bodies. What comes into your mind when talking about bodies as an archive of trauma, of pain, of memory?
Well, immediately I think back to like really looking at these images, and I was looking at this image. So I'll speak of one image in the archives, in the National Archives of Zambia, and the one image in the National Archives of Zimbabwe. So this one image in the National Archives of Zambia is an image of women, and they're wearing only the chitenge, the fabric, the wrapper, at the bottom part, and then they are laying down, you know? They are laying down on the floor, and there's really no context or information as to what this image is or something like this. It's just an image you see, and you already think of the corporeal function, you know, of the politicalness of this body in this particular time. And in my work, of course, I'm particularly interested in independence movements, liberation struggles, and things like this. And you think about what this body is trying to tell us in this present day, this body that is photographed, particularly in the past, you know? And it's really very difficult to tell whether it's a body being subjected to pain or it's a body that is fighting for its rights, you know, because you also kind of want to bear in mind particular kinds of movements or particular kinds of actions that women were doing in these liberation movements, from stripping and putting their bodies at risk, you know. So it's really that thin line of trying to understand what that is trying to communicate. And then I think of another image, the one in the National Archives of Zimbabwe, which is an image of bodies, like a lot of bodies buried in a mass grave, you know. And that one's already traumatic just from what it depicts, you know. That one speaks more directly of loss, you know, like sure, maybe victory in the end, but surely if not telling us of the actual pain, it tells us of, you know, like it's a deep sense of pain in itself of what this is historically. And to think about what those stories mean today, you know, if you think about memory in itself, memory, I think just like healing or remembering is very complex in itself, you know. You know, memory is never, even though it presents this way in the archives, it presents itself as very stable in the archives because, you know, they're kind of like controlled and things like this. But it's very chaotic sometimes, and it's continuously in a state of flux, like almost the same way as these images. Like it's very difficult to tell whether, like I said, is it a memory of victory or a memory of pain, or is it both? You know, it's okay if it's both as well, but really looking at this idea. But in terms of looking at the idea of memory also, maybe in relation to the archive, I think of this book. It's called, I have to remember, In and Out of the Archive. You know, mm-hmm. It's like, curator, something like this. You think about what it means when memory goes into the archive and then when it goes outside and how we interact with it. I think the body, as you speak about, as you question, really does speak to this idea of something in which memory lives in, that's kind of outside an archive or outside a story that you are told to remember a certain way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, archives often, archives always are setting the narration and the context and erase a certain story and have a dominant other one, which is very, very often a violent one. I got the feeling that the body is very important for you in your artwork, even if it does not appear. I know other works by you, Gestures of Mourning, and also I attended a intervention you did in Berlin, an artistic intervention in public space, Pursuing Colonial Traces, where you gave ask the audience those fabrics, material, which is originally used to wrap dead bodies. So even if no bodies were there, we had this material and we had to wrap it around lanterns, imagining that there were bodies, all these dead bodies maybe that are there. Yeah, it's very touching. It's always very touching, the work you're doing in this regard. Do you think, as an artist, I mean, we already talked about that art is maybe then the language when there are no words for it. Do you think art is a tool of healing, can be a tool of healing? What is the one first part of the questions? The second part of the question is, doing art work for you a healing practice for you personally?
I mean, definitely, yes. And I think about it also in making other kinds of work, you know, like when you, for me particularly, is that I'm going into these archives and I'm seeing some images that are not very nice to see. And some of the work, it takes time to make. If you think of these wreaths are laid in honor of her memories, which is the swings and the flowers on it, you know, the making of the flowers individually, it becomes, therapeutic, because it's one by one. And I'm not necessarily making them when I'm sitting down and like, oh, I'm making artwork, you know, I'm making them when I'm sitting down. And this is very therapeutic to me in some way, is although when I start making them, I know why I'm making them, but in the process of making them, it just becomes a gesture of my hands are making something, you know, and my mind could be doing something else. I also think about it in relation to these moments are spent in seeing her invisibility, which is the flagpoles with the fabric that's wrapped around them. So this is also quite cutting. So these are actions that seem quite mundane in the beginning, you know, because you're just like cutting and it's really not doing much, but it comes really very therapeutic. You think about it in terms of, if you were to see a therapist, the therapist would be like, oh, okay, try not to think about this. By not thinking about this, try to do something else, you know? So this is in some way, you know, because it is true. You know, sometimes when they are trying to talk to you and you're trying to heal, of course, maybe from mentally, from something, it's not easy to tell somebody to like, no, just don't think about it. It's like, what am I going to think about now? You know, so... You know, it kind of substitutes that, because your mind becomes very, you know, very, what's the word for it? It becomes engaged in what you're doing in that moment. So I think it does.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it's again the body. It's again you using your body and doing gestures, doing movements, doing something with your body, and it goes through your body.
Yeah, yes. And I mean, also there is moments of when you're done with the work and sometimes you're talking about the work, you know, this also is a form of dealing with something, to speak about something.
Mm-hmm.
Or that something becomes the channel through which you speak about something. Because like right now we're talking about healing and we're talking about trauma, we're talking about history, but we're using art as the channel to talk about these kinds of important issues.
Yeah.
Which actually means healing in itself, right? Yeah. That we are also part of the process.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. Do you think, I mean, a talking objects project is also dealing with these questions of how do we look at objects and how can we heal in this regard? Do you think that this also healing also concerns objects against the backdrop of the debate of return repair, restitution?
I think so, yeah, because the reason I think so is because when we're doing some of these performances or filming, we're using materials that mean something, you know, like you were just speaking of the back cloth. The material in itself, the back cloth as an object, is important because it's used to wrap dead bodies, yes. And also it's something that has, its production has gone down since the introduction of Arab cloths and Arab traders and of course superstitions around death, which also in itself as an object begins to symbolize erasure. It begins to symbolize something that passes out. So it is very important to consider what objects are being used, whether it's in these performances or in these rituals or reperformances of a particular something. Or if I think about it again in terms of my work, it is important to think of the object of paper, right? What paper versus an object like marble, which is very permanent, and which is going to tell you again that memory is very permanent and, you know, it's solid. It's a solid truth. If it's in marble or bronze, then it's true. But then what does it mean if you then make a monument outside the traditional material? I think there's very interesting, you know, linkages between objects and their function, whether it is their function actually in society or their function to make meaning, is very important, I think.
Yeah, yeah. That's also what we were talking about in Dakar when we had our discussion on le langage des objets, the language of the objects, where we had a central installation by the artist Villiers Dibas, who was reacting on one object from the Musée Théodore Monod. And he was very, very much into this question of what the material can tell you, what is metal telling you, what is fabric telling you, and what, how can we sense it, touch it, smell it, to discover what is in it, what memories and what narrations and narratives are archived in these materials. That was very interesting. What about the curatorial practice? It just comes into my mind, the last book from Bonaventure and Dicong, The Illusions of Care, where he also discusses the role of the curator who cares about the artwork. And he said, his quote is, how can we imagine curating as a process that might eventually lead to some kind of social and spiritual healing? So let's jump into this spirituality, spiritual healing. What is it for you? Next question.
Another comment. Well, when I think of spirituality, I think religion, right? And whatever religion it is, I think religion has a very special function in healing, particularly in relation to death or to loss. I think it's important for closure, number one. It's important in a way of thinking about what happens to what is lost. Yeah. When I was making my work, I draw very much from practices of mourning and what people do, what practices surround people do when they're surrounding death. And I drew very much from the context of Zambia and Zimbabwe and what people would do during funerals and how they behave in relation to the departed, you know, the way you care for the actual body and the way you think and say that, okay, no, you need to have a funeral and somehow convince the departed that you are departed now and you need to come to terms with this. And, you know, from paying of last respects to burying the dead and to having memorial services around the person who's dead in some way to tell the person that, no, you're not forgotten, you know. How I think all this might happen, yes, in the physical, but it has very much to do with healing the spirit, you know. And also spiritually, it's this idea to think that something never really goes away. We think, okay, the body might decompose, this might happen, but this, the spirit is still gonna be there. You know, if it's not, if you don't believe in some way that maybe, okay, their spirit is hovering somewhere or it has gone to some particular space, we actually think about it in terms of it, traces of it remain, you know, whether it's in the clothes the person wore, the particular something somebody liked, the song the person liked, or something that just reminds you of that particular person, you know, mm-hmm. I would think.
Mm. Again, wholeness, filling the gaps, maybe also. Talking about wholeness and about interaction, healing as a social and communicative procedure. We had an interesting conversation 2 days ago with Mahret. It was very interesting. We talked about the relationship between the global north and the global south, and that this relationship, and you said this relationship is very, very problematic, but we just cannot split up. We have to do it, and we have to go in couple therapy. And that's also what healing means and what is never considered, this couple therapy between global north and global south.
Yeah, it's actually a very problematic relationship that we can't it's there. We have to live through it and then find possible ways to make it as equal and good as possible, I guess. And then I have to think of like bell hooks also in this context, and her idea of being in relation with each other, and despite like the histories or also like the structural positions we are always carrying with us, and it's actually a challenge, but I think a really, really important one.
Mm-hmm. I would like to jump in for a minute and encourage the audience to raise questions. You can use the chat box if you want to have questions to Gladys, because time is running. It's already 9:05, at least in Berlin. and we
in
also-
In Frankfurt also.
Yeah, in Frankfurt also. and we also wanna show Tabita Rezaire's work. But maybe there's no question for the moment. So maybe what I do is, before we all talk, we all saw the film, also Gladys. So I'm happy if we just share our ideas to make a brief introduction to the artwork from Raabe Rezaire, which we want to show later. It's a bit longer work. It's 18 minutes. We will show this at the very end. But before I would like to introduce you to Tabita Rezaire for a moment. She sent us a text about herself, which I'm going to read. Tabita Rezaire is infinity longing to experience itself in human form. Her path as an artist, devotee, yogi, doula, and soon to be farmer is all geared towards manifesting the divine in herself and beyond. As an eternal seeker, Tabita's yearning for connection finds expression in her cross-dimensional practices, which envisions network science, organic, electronic, and spiritual as healing technologies to serve the shift towards heart consciousness. Embracing digital, corporeal, and ancestral memory, she digs into scientific imaginaries and mystical realms to tackle the colonial wounds and energetic imbalances that affects the songs of our body, mind, spirits. Through screen interfaces and healing circles, her offerings aim to nurture our collective growth and expand our capacity for togetherness. Tabita is based near Cayenne in French Guiana, where she's currently studying agriculture and birthing Amakaba, her vision for collective healing in the Amazonian forest. Tabita is devoted to become a mother of the world. So this is what she wrote about herself. And I would suggest to now hear her artistic statement, which is at the same time an introduction to her project Amakaba in the Amazonian forest. And then we can maybe discuss on this. So Jack, if you want to show this short Amakaba film, thanks. But well, there's no sound again. We had this problem before.
Seeker.
Amakaba.
Welcome to the Amazonian forest of French Guiana. My name is Tabita Rezaire. I'm an artist, yogi, doula, but essentially I'm a spiritual seeker, longing to experience the depths of existence. And it is from this ancestral land that I'd like to share with you my vision, Amakaba.
Amakaba!
Amakaba is a healing center. It's a place for the transmission of the wisdom of the earth, the body, and the sky. It's a space of gathering, of experimentation, collaboration, of celebration in the middle of the forest through art, science, and spirituality. The ambition is to contribute to a more conscious and responsible way of living and being, and to respond creatively to the many challenges we face, ecologically, socially, politically, and to heal from the trauma of the land, of our bodies, our wombs, our communities. Above all, it's about establishing a spiritual anchor, a place to celebrate our ancestors, the river, the forest, its spirit, and to nurture our intimacy with each other, ourselves, the land, and the whole of creation. For this, Amakaba is building an agroecological farm. Right now, I'm studying agriculture and planning to grow cacao. I've been called by this plant and being initiated by its wisdom. So we are setting up an agroforestry system because agriculture should not be synonymous with deforestation, especially in the Amazonian context. We are planning to design an autonomous system in terms of energy and waste management, considering the whole infrastructure as an organism and architecture as medicine. Amakaba is also home to a yoga center. I've been teaching Kundalini yoga for 6 years, and the science of yoga has been transformational in my healing journey. To understand the power of the body, its memory, its wisdom, and the need to align body, mind, and spirit, always guided by the wisdom of the womb. Womb healing is central to Amakaba's vision. Through doula work and advocacy, our mission is also here to support mothers and the next generation in their transition to Earth. Amakaba is about birth on so many levels, from the birth of a plant, of a child, of another dimension of existence. From seeds to planets, the exploration of the celestial realms is also part of the vision. We'll build an observatory above the canopy for astronomical observation, stargazing, full moon meditation, a place to experience the infinity of the sky. Amakaba is also holding ceremonies and celebration for the ancestors, for the spirit of the forest, the spirit of the water, for the harvest, birth, death, and all great transitions of existence. In alignment with the rhythm of the sky, the equinox, the solstice, and the moon cycles. In essence, Amakaba is an offering in reverence of the ancestors, like a place of initiation, a place to be transformed, to grow, to bloom, like in a womb, to be rebirthed, guided by the Amazonian forest. If this vision finds resonance within you, Amakaba needs you, your support, your talent, your prayers, to find the land that will receive this vision and all my seedling growing in the nursery. I hope to receive you here one day. Thank you to the land, the ancestors, and to you all.
Amakaba! Amakaba!
Yeah, so this is where she is at the moment in the Amazonian forest, and the internet is not so well working there, so she cannot join us today, which is understandable. Yeah, so I was quite impressed about her new endeavor, Amakaba, which is actually combines, let's say, the whole range of what caring and healing is. It's about spiritual practice, about collective practices, about caring for the environment, healthcare, body, self-care, and also care as a form of refusal. And that's something I find very interesting, form of refusal and resistance in that kind, that you refuse to play the game, you withdraw to the Amazonian forest. So maybe we can just for a minute talk about caring, healing as a form of refusal.
Healing or caring as a form of refusal, or both?
Caring, actually.
Healing as a form of to that there's a moment of healing when you would start to refuse being part of a system or a structure, that you could you just disconnect kind of yourself to be able to probably connect with other aspects that have been kind of suppressed or neglected beforehand.
Are you doing this, Gladys? Are you refusing sometimes, like, in order to take care of yourself?
Does refusing, is refusing similar to protesting or to resisting in some way?
I don't know. I wouldn't say so. It depends how you define protest.
I mean, protest would be to, again, to use your word, to refuse to to succumb to something. You know, it would be like if you dare to remember, you protest to erase, basically. It's how I think about it. It's you're refusing a particular something. I'm not quite sure. I'm trying to connect it or think about it in this way, you know, because I think to refuse, you know, to refuse for me kind of gives me this gesture, you know, to be like, I don't know what the word for it in English is, but to push back, maybe. Yeah, to push back. Or I think it can take many forms. Like, refusing doesn't necessarily mean to say no to me, or it doesn't necessarily mean that it has to be like an outright, oh, I'm going to say no, whatever it is. You can just refuse inside you and just be like, I refuse, you know. Like,
yeah, I agree. Maybe,
you know.
Do you think that being an artist makes you maybe more vulnerable? Is being an artist a vulnerable thing for you? Or
no.
Not?
No. Vulnerable in what sense? Like, I think sometimes we speak of our vulnerabilities, but then maybe just our vulnerabilities in general. But being an artist, not so much, no. I don't know, I wouldn't think about it in that way, because I think being an artist kind of gives a sense of freedom to do certain things, you know? Of course, I'm bearing in mind that there's different artists in different contexts and facing different conditions or something like this. But in my particular case, no, not so much. No, I don't think so. Like, I think it's just maybe, or maybe I've just become comfortable with expressing some of my other vulnerabilities or worries, because my work does this already, sort of, it does speak to the idea of talking to pain. So obviously, maybe I've become accustomed to thinking about my own traumas and dealing with my own traumas, and looking also at the way in which I make my work with people who are really close to me, it's sort of becomes a more supportive practice, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. I mean, facing, being able to face one's trauma and pain could also be something that is very powerful, of course, because then something is going into a transition, and this is always, I mean, something is moving, something is changing, and then a new energy comes up, and it could be something very powerful as well. Again, time is running, so we have to briefly introduce the next film, Deep Down Tidal by Tabita Rezaire, which is a kind of break, but we anyway decided to show it. It proposes, let's say, kind of cosmological, spiritual, technological narrative of water. Water as something that is an archive for, again, for memories, for spirituality, but also for healing. And that's what I found very powerful in this film. I don't know, I'm curious about your ideas or your thoughts about it.
My thoughts about it were, first of all, it's very interesting to see that we will see like the contrast with Tabita being in the Amazonian forest beforehand with his nature, and then now we're going to see this film, which is quite technical, digital in a way. So I think I really like that contrast, because it's probably not what you would expect after the introduction if you don't know the work already. And also in connection to the first part of this event, where we had this panel with all those transatlantic actually connections, and which is also a huge part of Deep Down Tidal, this connectedness between the continent, between the continents, and the wires, like, you know, that are lying on the, like, on the Atlantic Ocean's ground, that now connect the worlds, and the idea of some kind of like digital colonialism that just changed its form, and what it how a colonialism continues to work in different forms. And that's what I found quite interesting, like, as I said, also in connection to the first part of this event.
Mm-hmm. Gladys, do you want to add anything, or should we just start with the film?
I think we can start the film.
Okay. So then, Jack.
Hey, I ain't your mama. I ain't gonna do your laundry. Hello, my friend. I'm good, and you? Oh, actually, I'm not good. Yes, it's this internet thing, this Facebook thing, yes, you know. No, my friend, it's like I've posted something about the white people saying that they should give our land back, you know. Yes. And they've banned me from Facebook. Can you believe that? Or idiot or something like that, I don't know.
This is racism on a serious note. This is really not good. It's like they are not treating us equally. They are not treating us like human beings. Oh, my friend, you know this data thing, they really need to fall, you know. Yes, because we are wasting our money buying data instead of buying cold drink and a dress or a bread or something like that, you know.
Electronic colonialism is the domination and control of digital technologies by the West to maintain and expand their hegemonic power over the rest of the world. Sarbad warned us in 1995 when he wrote, "The West desperately needs new places to conquer. When they do not actually exist, they must be created. Enter cyberspace." Electronic colonialism is one of the many ways in which colonial domination survived after its defeat. While settler colonialism was the policy and practice of acquiring, controlling, occupying, and economically exploiting land and labor, which by the way is still a thing, it's just now called capitalism. Electronic colonialism seeks to influence and control the mind through the digital device. It also operates by sustaining the dependency of former colonized countries on the West by the importation of hardware, software, engineers, technicians, and information protocols. This creates a set of foreign norms, values, and expectations that alter and marginalize local cultures, languages, habits, values, and lifestyles in favor of Eurocentric knowledge. Many countries in the global South have become electronic colonies that are force-fed information generated by the Western world. Under the guise of globalization, the information revolution has become a vehicle for cultural westernization. The internet is exploitative, oppressive, exclusionary, classist, patriarchal, racist, homophobic, transphobic, fatphobic, homophobic, coercive, and manipulative. The internet reproduces the West, offlines racial, economical, political, and cultural violence and domination, legitimized behind the idea of modernity and technological advancement.
Fiber optic cable.
perpetrators of slavery and colonialism tried and still try to defend and justify themselves with the civilization mission rhetoric. We brought culture and modernity to the savages, pretending their new trade routes were connecting the world. In reality, all they did was to steal land, massacre indigenous populations, exploit their resources and workforce to increase the wealth of their empires. Same stories with the internet. Multimedia giants claim we are connecting people to each other, while underneath they steal and exploit our data, our free labor, to increase the wealth and power of their media empires.
Thank you. one thing to have rain, it's one thing to have water, it's one thing to have appropriate water, clean water. When rainwater falls, especially the first rain, there are already pollutants in the atmosphere, so they wash it down. It falls on the roads, it sits from the roads, it sits along, it carries dirt, that's still pollution, isn't it? It carries oil, it carries everything that you have in the along its path. Water carries everything along its path. Water is not as the way it used to be because of industrialization. We like industrialization. We want, everybody wants life easy. What industrialization has is aimed at is making life easy or quicker. So we have cars to go here quickly, we don't walk. So we have washing machines to wash our plates, we don't even want to wash them. We want the best convenience. We want things to be done well. There is a cost. It takes up the natural. It takes up what you're supposed to get naturally. And to me, that's the price you pay. Because all what we call pollutants, or so you see in wastewater, you see in domestic water, on hospital, everything which is there is something that has been man-made. Belief is that water is holy when you pray for it, and it makes us to bring out living water. It makes our voice, to our sound, to be something that can cleanse. You get it? Our actions to cleanse, our life to cleanse, you know, to be alive. They speak much more than just ordinary things. You know, whenever water passes somewhere, it leaves a trace. There's no way you can put water somewhere without a trace. Every single person has a responsibility, and it's that consciousness of the fact that whatever I do now affects my tomorrow, and your tomorrow is not what just necessarily what belongs to you, but there's a generation coming ahead. You know, what every little effort you make now affects generations ahead, affect not just when it has to deal with water, it doesn't just affect people, it affects the soil, it affects the ground, it affects the plant, and it's a whole life circle. That out of you will flow rivers of living water.
Dino calouvri modewe, ka change mo la vie. Ki sa nou te ke fe sanglo, di lo mo contento. Mou ka admire to force, pas nou sabe fo panga. Mais la la to lis, to bel, lis kouto lo mon. Pour arriver ça une Dieu va seulement n'y a que condom à la beauté la Guyane traverser prix rivière à la beauté la Guyane traverser prix rivière dis dis-le qu'à l'ouvrir mon déway qu'à changer mon la vie. Qui s'annoute et qui fait sanglot, dit le mot contento. In some countries in the world, you are terribly missing. In Ethiopia, Biafra, many children are dying. But we hope a day you'll come, then you'll be there to save them. And people will be happy, and people will be singing. And people will be happy, and people will be singing and dancing too. Dis-le, l'ouvrir mon déway, qu'a changé mon la vie, qui s'annoute et qui fait sanglot, dis-le mon contento, dis-le mon contento, dis-le mon contento.
Well,
our water is traumatized. Water remembers all that has been. So we are back at the beginning from our talk today.
Yes, absolutely. And it's a pity that Tabita is not here for discussion. But at the same time, sometimes artworks can also speak for themselves, right? So and actually we are at the end of our event now, and that was actually the idea to have this to show this art piece in the end, so we can like glide into the evening or like into the afternoon after this event with some really inspiring input, I guess. And for this, I would very much like to thank all the participants and the audience, and of course 1014 for the cooperation. And in the backdrop, Selina and Jack, they were invisible, but contributed heavily in the background. And talking objects and Talking Objects Lab, there is our website, of course. And at some point, also this event, the recording of this event will be posted there. And there is much more to find on our website, talkingobjectslab.org. And there are some other events coming up next year. So, yeah. I also wish like a very good festive season, of course. And so Isabel, is there something you want to add?
Yes, well, in these times, take care, speak about today's topic, be careful, stay healthy, care for yourself, and start full of good energy, good spirits in the next year. Thank you all.
Thank you all. Thank you, Gladys, again for being here with us.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye.